Okay, so everybody, we start our seminar with talk of Michel Brion from Grenoble. He will speak on the rigidity of homomorphisms of algebraic groups. So please.
Okay, so thank you very much for the invitation. It's a pleasure and an honor to speak there at this seminar. And my talk is related in several ways in the work of some people in the seminar, especially Ernest Borisovitch-Winberg. So you will see this a little bit later. So here is a plan of the talk. I'll start with two questions. And the statement of the main result in a kind of loose version without being too specific. Then some background on homomorphisms of algebraic groups and families of homomorphisms. Then a precise version of the main result and two applications. This precise version will consist in two statements, one existence statement and one rigidity statement. And I'll sketch a proof first of the second statement, rigidity, which is related with Zariski tangent spaces and involves Lie algebras in an essential way. And the rest of the talk will be really on algebraic groups with few Lie algebras. There will be some structural results for linearly reductive groups. I'll give details for this. And a proof sketch of the existence result in the main theorem. Okay, so that was the plan. And let me begin with introduction. So I will consider homomorphisms of algebraic groups from G to H. G and H are algebraic groups over an algebraically closed field, which could be of arbitrary characteristic. If you insist, you can work with K equals C throughout the talk. There will be some small things which will come in addition. And this set of homomorphisms has an action of the group H by conjugation, or rather of its K points, if you want to be fussy. You just conjugate on the target. And the questions I will consider are the following. First of all, is there a natural geometric structure on this set of homomorphisms, which is just an abstract set? And how to describe the H orbits or the conjugacy classes. And the aim of the talk is to sketch a proof of the following theorem. If G is linearly reductive, this means that every representation of G is semi-simple, then this set of homomorphism has a natural structure of a scheme. And for this structure, every orbit is open.
May I ask a question? So in positive characteristic, you just assume that G is a torus.
No,
Other...
there are more because I don't assume G to be connected in this
Ah,
paper.
okay. I see. Thank you.
And in the paper, I don't assume it to be smooth, but it's another matter. In the talk, let's consider a smooth groups.
But the connected component is a torus, yes?
Not even so, because you see, G is not assumed to be linear.
I see.
So you may as well take for G an abelian variety, or say an elliptic curve, because it has no non-trivial representations. So it's trivially linearly reductive. Okay, so you allow non-linear groups, and I allow non-linear groups in this talk. Okay,
Okay.
but even with linear groups, even with a multiplicative group GM, you get spaces of homomorphism which are not varieties because they are way too big. For example, if you look at group homomorphism from GM to GM, you get only the power maps with any integer, positive or negative. And so you get this bijection with Z. And actually, the scheme structure in the theorem is just a constant scheme. You just take an infinite copy of points. And so it's not an affine scheme. Okay, so you have to work with big objects. That's what I want to insist on. Okay, so you can ask the same kind of questions for morphisms of algebraic varieties. You just forget about groups. And then there is a recent result of Fürther and Kraft in a preprint from this year. Let me state it as they state it. I try to just to extract results from the paper and reproduce them. So you take an algebraically closed field of characteristic zero and two affine varieties. And then this space of morphisms has a natural structure of an affine int variety. I'll recall the definition in a minute. And if you specialize to algebraic groups, G and H, and you look at homomorphisms or group morphisms, then what you get is a closed subset of morphisms and hence an affine int variety. And this int variety is finite dimensional. And if you start with a reductive group and land into GLN, then you get a countable union of closed H orbits. So in the statement I want to prove, you can replace GLN with any algebraic group, basically. And you get the same result. And let me recall briefly the main notions in this theorem. First of all, an int variety is an increasing union of algebraic varieties, Mn, indexed by non-negative integers. And it comes with a Zariski topology for which a subset n of m is closed if its intersection with Mn is closed in Mn for all n. And the dimension is the supremum of the dimensions of the Mn. So it could be finite or infinite.
Dr. Michel, in your first example with multiplicative groups, the dimension is zero.
Yes.
Yes. Yes. Right. Counted by many points which are for dimension zero.
Yes. Okay. Yes. Exactly.
Okay.
But if you take Hom GM to GLN, then you obtain components of arbitrarily high dimension. Okay. So that's one nice statement. As you will see, with if you work with schemes instead of varieties, the situation is very different. I first want to give you some precise definitions. Again, the Grand field is algebraically closed of characteristic P, which can be zero or positive. A variety is not necessarily affine, so that's a technical definition. And you may think of it, but as follows, you glue finitely many affine varieties along open affine subvarieties. And the separation axiom is that the diagonal is closed. Okay, so an algebraic group is just the usual notion of group variety. And it's smooth, because it's reduced and could be not connected in this talk. And the main definition is that of a family of morphisms from a variety to another one over some object S. This is just a morphism from X times S to Y. And S could be a variety or a scheme. We will use both. And you may think of this as a family of morphisms Fs, where S is a K point for S, and you just fix this and this rural in S. And for people used to schemes, this is just an S morphism from X times S to Y times S. And there is a standard operation on families, which is a pullback. If you have a family over S and a morphism from S prime to S, you can form a family over S prime by just this assignment. And this gives you a new family. And now I can formulate the main question. Is there a universal family from X times N to Y such that every family is obtained by pullback by a unique morphism to M? Okay, and some first remarks. If this M exists, then we know its K points, points over the field, because we just look at families over the points, right? They correspond to morphisms from the point to M. In fact, we know it's big K points for all field extensions of small k, because you can play the same game with what you get by base change. If you have a small k variety, you get a big K1 by base change, and you do this. And so the questions I was mentioning can be reformulated as follows. So let G and H be algebraic groups. First of all, is there a universal family of homomorphisms? And how to describe the H orbits in M? Here I will just mention that using the universal property of the family, you get a canonical action on H on M. This is playing with Yoneda's lemma or whatever. So it's a formal thing. And if you work with linear algebraic groups in characteristic zero and families over affine invarieties, then these questions are answered by the work of Fürther and Kraft, which I will try to summarize. But over schemes, things are very different. And I will give a kind of strange example, which is the characters of the additive group. So you have to get used to this. You take for group G, the additive group, K plus, and for H, a multiplicative group, K star product, and you ask for homomorphisms from G to H. And you know very well that they are all constants. But we have to see how this result extends to families. So first, I will do this carefully for families of varieties. So I consider first a morphism of varieties from GA times S to GM, where S is a variety. And this can be translated into a purely algebraic statement by looking at coordinate rings of these varieties. You want a homomorphism of algebras from the coordinate ring of GM, this is my notation or the scheme notation for this, to that of GA times S. And this is just a homomorphism of algebras. Then you just write what this means. So the left-hand side is a Laurent polynomial ring in T and T inverse. And the right-hand side is a polynomial ring in one variable coordinate on GA over functions on S. So what you get is this homomorphism of algebras. So this is just given by the image of T, which is invertible. So it's just an invertible polynomial with coefficients in O of S. And O of S is a reduced ring. So invertible polynomial is just constant. And if you translate back into geometric terms, what you get is, There is a universal family, which is a constant family, which sends every pair xy to y. So it's a kind of rather stupid conclusion. But if you specialize to families of homomorphisms, then the image of zero is one by the group homomorphism. And so the constant is one. And so you see, as expected, that every family of homomorphisms over a variety is just trivial. But over a scheme, I claim there is no universal family. And in fact, we will construct bigger and bigger families which prevent the existence of a universal one. So let me again do this slowly. Suppose you have a universal family over a scheme. Then by the previous argument, the k points of this scheme are just one point for any field extension. And so what you get is an affine scheme, because it's covered by affine schemes and it has a unique point. And so it corresponds to some commutative k algebra A. And then this family corresponds to a polynomial P in A of X. This is a polynomial in ring, which satisfies this identity identically in XY, because it's a group homomorphism. So it's a multiplicative polynomial, so to say. And the universal property gives you some statement about K algebras for any K algebra B and for any multiplicative polynomial Q. Q is obtained from P by a homomorphism of algebra from A to B. You just take P, apply the homomorphism U to the coefficients, and you get Q. And in particular, the degree of this polynomial is uniformly bounded. It's just at most a degree of P. But then we get a contradiction by constructing multiplicative polynomials in of arbitrarily large degree. And the idea is to take the exponential series, which is certainly satisfies this identity, right? If you take P equals exponential, you get this, right? An exponential is not a polynomial, but you can truncate it arbitrarily by working of over truncated power, truncated polynomial rings. Take B to be the quotient of the polynomial ring K of T by the ideal generated by T to the n plus one, and take Q, this exponential series. And then it's clearly multiplicative. And so there is no family of homomorphisms in characteristic zero, because you need to invert all these integers n factorial. And in positive characteristic, it's even simpler. You take some additive polynomial like 1 plus t x to the p to the n, which is additive in x, where t square is zero. So you see, schemes are really different from varieties in this respect.
If you pass to formal schemes, could it help? If you allow completions, then
you can work directly with the exponential, yes.
Then I mean the question in this category, is it an open question about existence of universal families?
It still doesn't exist because, I don't know.
Okay.
I don't know. It's not clear to me because I guess you get uh, you can get a universal family in characteristic zero using the exponential.
Okay, thank you.
And in characteristic P, you take a universal P polynomial, okay, with all powers of P to all sum of monomials of the form X to the P to the N for all N. But then it's a huge space. It's not still a formal scheme, but very large. So that's what I guess. But again, I'm not enough familiar with formal schemes to be sure of myself. Okay. So now you can extend this picture to additive one-parameter subgroups. And for simplicity, I will assume characteristic zero. And I consider a homomorphism from GA to H. Again, for simplicity, let's take for H a non-trivial connected linear algebraic group with Lie algebra Gothic H. And then you get a universal family by the exponential series, which is a polynomial. Okay, that's extremely easy. You just copy the usual proof over fields, that morphisms from additive group to H are exponentials of elements in the Lie algebra. But and this works if your group H is unipotent, because the Lie algebra is nilpotent, so this you get indeed a polynomial. But if you have a non-unipotent group, then there is no universal family over schemes, because H contains a copy of the multiplicative group, and then the previous argument works. But there is a universal family over an affine variety for any such H over the nilpotent variety of the Lie algebra. And this is proved by Furter and Kraft in essence. They don't state it in this way, but that's what they do. So again, there is a big difference. There is a nilpotent variety, but there is no nilpotent scheme somehow. Questions so far? Okay, so let me continue and state the main result. So first of all, the definition of linearly reductive is what I already mentioned. Every finite dimensional representation is completely reducible or semi-simple. And here are examples, tori, as mentioned by Dima. You can also consider finite groups of order prime to the characteristic. So all finite groups in characteristic zero, and all reductive groups in characteristic zero. And again, you can consider abelian varieties. This means connected algebraic groups which are projective as a varieties, because their representations are all trivial. And the main theorem says that if you start with a linearly reductive group and land into an algebraic group, then there is a universal family of homomorphisms over a scheme. And this scheme is a union of countably many open H orbits. Countably many is not proved in the archive preprint, but it's easy, and I will explain a bit later how this works. And the assumption to be linearly reductive looks a bit artificial, but there is a converse. So if you assume that if you are given G and you assume that the theorem holds for all linear algebraic groups H, then G is linearly reductive. And what is used here is the second assertion, the fact that all these orbits are open, which is a rigidity result. Possibly the existence of M holds and for other groups G, but I don't know exactly which ones. Okay, so next I will first prove or sketch how to prove this rigidity result. But first, let me give some applications of this main result. So the first one says the following. You consider a linearly reductive group, and by group as in the main theorem, and you consider h orbits or hk orbits in the homomorphisms, and the same objects for an algebraically closed field extension big K. And then the statement is that the natural map from this one to this one is a bijection. And this is a proposition in a paper of Winberg, where he considers G connected linear and H linear connected also, and was extended by a mathematician called Margot a little bit 10 years ago, again for G linear. But actually, if you know that there is a universal scheme, it's a formal consequence of this, because the small k points of this universal scheme are just the group homomorphisms, and the scheme is a disjoint union of open orbits of such points. And so you can see how its connected components are. They are just the orbits of the identity or neutral component H naught. And so the orbit space you are considering here can be obtained in steps. First of all, you take the H naught orbits, and then you take the H mod H naught orbits. And in this first step, what you get is a set of connected components. And here you divide by the action of the group of connected components of H. But this both sets only depend on the scheme M and not on the algebraically closed field you are working with. Connected components are unchanged by going to a larger algebraically closed field extension. So that's why this statement holds. And it's a bit strange because this result is really the main result of the paper of Margot, which is a rather long paper. And it seems that this paper turns around the existence of this scheme M without going there. But again, once you have it, you just have this statement. So let me formulate a second application to homomorphism from a finite group to an algebraic group. And I will assume that the finite group has order prime to the characteristic P, characteristic which is no assumption in characteristic zero. And then a statement is that there are only finitely many conjugated classes of homomorphism from G to H. So the proof is very easy. First of all, if you look at morphisms from G to H, then it's very easy to show that there is a universal scheme, which is H to the N, where N is an order of, this should be G. This is really the order of G. Okay, I'll correct this on the notes. And so you have a universal scheme for homomorphisms when you just write the condition for a morphism to be multiplicative in terms of the elements of G. And so this condition is closed in Hn. And so you get a scheme of finite type. And H is linearly reductive by classical result. So every H orbit is open. And since you work in a finite type scheme, you get that there are finitely many orbits. So this applies to the classification of G actions on a, say, project.
Sorry, Michel, you mean say yes? G is linearly reductive, not H.
I'm sorry, yes.
This is a Zimarski theorem.
Yes, you're completely right. So first of all, this n is the order of g, and then this h should be a g. Okay. Thank you.
Okay.
Well, you see, there are always mistakes.
It's in the sprint.
Okay. Well, thank you. Now I think things are clear, except that there are typos. Okay, so back to the classification of actions of a finite group on a projective variety. They correspond bijectively to homomorphism from G to the automorphism group of X, which is actually a locally algebraic group or algebraic group with infinitely many components, possibly. But if this out of X is an algebraic group, then you get that there are only finitely many conjugacy classes of G actions on X, just by this proposition. And the assumption that out of X is an algebraic group is fulfilled if X has complexity one or zero under the action of a reductive group. This is a theorem of Argentzeff and other people. If X is rational, and I think I proved it is in general. So it's not a very complicated proof. But then there is a recent result of Dean, Ogiso, and Yu, which says that there exists a smooth projective rational surface X such that its automorphism group has infinitely many conjugacy classes of involutions. And so this results shows that the assumption that out of X is an algebraic group cannot be suppressed in this statement, because the group with two elements gives you a counter example. And this construction is really clever. It also gives a smooth projective rational surface over the complex numbers, which has infinitely many non-equivalent real forms. And that's how it's presented first in the paper. Okay. So one has to be careful with these applications. Okay, so let me go to the proof or proof sketch. And first I will discuss Zariski tangent spaces. And the idea is if you have a scheme structure on your universal space, then you get information on its tangent spaces just by formal considerations. And so I have to remind you how this Zariski tangent space works for a scheme or variety. So consider a scheme and a k rational point. And the Zariski tangent space is a dual of m mod m squared, which is a small k vector space, where M is the maximal ideal of the local ring. That's the usual definition. And there is a more scheme theoretic definition. You consider the algebra of dual numbers, which is the quotient of the polynomial ring in T by T squared. So it's a kind of infinitesimal of point with one direction. And then the Zariski tangent space of S at small s is the preimage of small s under the map from d points of s to the k points of s, which has evaluation or going mod t d. And actually, if you look at s of d, what you get is a tangent bundle to s, so to say. So the collection of points plus tangent vectors. And we apply this observation to morphisms of varieties. So assume you have a universal family of morphisms from X to Y. And then you know what it's the A points of MR for any K algebra A. This is a formal consideration. And what you get is the following. If the target Y is a smooth variety, then the tangent space of this M at any morphism F is the space of sections on X of the pullback of the tangent bundle to Y. Okay. Well, that's again very formal, and it's also in the literature on group schemes in some involved form, but it's a kind of simple lemma. So you know a priori what should be the Zariski tangent space just by looking at this. Now we are interested in group homomorphisms. So we take for Y an algebraic group H, and then the tangent bundle, as you well know, is a trivial bundle with fiber, the Lie algebra Gothic H at the neutral element. So if you input this in this statement, what you get is the following: tangent space of M at small f is the space of morphisms from X to the Lie algebra of H. And this is just morphisms of varieties. Okay. And you see, it's a very big space. Usually it's infinite dimensional. Now, again, we are interested in group homomorphisms. So that will be the next slide. So we start with an algebraic group G and look at and assume there is a universal family of homomorphisms with universal scheme M. And then you look at the Zariski tangent space of M at small f, and what you find is the space of one cocycles from the group G to the Lie algebra H. One cocycles are defined by this relation, where you have to explain how the group G acts on the Lie algebra H, and it acts in the kind of obvious way. You have a homomorphism from G to H, and you compose it with the adjoint representation. And this is a subspace of hom GH, which is more or less a Zariski tangent space to morphisms. Okay. So that's again a formal result. And the next observation is point is to compute the Zariski tangent space to the orbit of this F. And you have an orbit map, which is given by conjugation of the source of the target, right? And if you compute differentials of this map, and you find that the image of the differential is a subspace of one co-boundaries, which I wrote in this way. These are assignments. G maps to G Z minus C, where C is an H. Okay. So again, these are formal computations. And now what you get is a first cohomology group of G with coefficients in the Lie algebra H. By definition, is a co-boundaries modulo the co-cycle, modulo the co-boundaries. And by these considerations, this is a normal space to the orbit in M. A normal space is just a quotient of the Zariski tangent space to M by the Zariski tangent space to the orbit, everything at the point F. Okay, so that's again a very formal part. Now I can prove a rigidity, which says that orbits are open. So for this, we assume that there is a universal family of homomorphisms where the scheme M is locally of finite type. This means that it's a union of open affine subschemes of finite type, but this union is not necessarily finite. And the main ingredient of the proof is very easy. if G is linearly reductive, then its group cohomology with values in any module is zero. Well, higher group cohomology. And in particular, H1 of GV is zero. And so the normal space to the orbit is zero. And it follows easily that the orbit is open. This is not completely trivial because you work with schemes instead of varieties, but this is not too hard. And let me sketch a proof that there are countably many such orbits. This is actually an argument of basic algebraic geometry, which has little to do with groups. So first of all, these groups are defined over some subfield of small k, which is finitely generated over the prime field, because the definitions of these groups only involve finitely many generators and relations. So you put the coefficients of this occurring is generators and regulations into this subfield, and you get this. So they are defined over a countable subfield. So you take the algebraic closure of this countable subfield, it's still countable. And now what you get is algebraic groups G prime, H prime over a countable algebraically closed subfield, such that G is obtained from G prime by base change, by field extension, and same for H. And then there is a slightly non-trivial fact that this G prime is still linearly reductive. Actually, this is proved in the paper of Margo. And now you apply the existence result to this pair G prime, H prime, and you find a universal scheme M prime. Then it's formal to see that M is obtained from M prime by field extension. And so we may assume that this K is countable because we have just to consider things in M prime. And then it suffices to show that the whole set of group homomorphisms is countable, or even that the set of morphisms is countable. But this is a general fact for any varieties, hom of XY is countable for any varieties XY over a countable algebraically closed field. For affine varieties is almost trivial, and for general ones, you have to work a little bit. So this proves rigidity. Any questions so far? Well, feel free to ask questions at any time. But then I will move to the, maybe before moving to the rest of the proof, I will make some further remarks on the existence of this universal scheme, because this has strong consequences which are not always well known, even for very classical objects. So let me be specific. So consider two varieties and assume that it's a universal scheme for morphisms. And then it's a formal consequence of results of Grothendieck that this scheme has to be locally of finite type. I will not give details because it's not the most funny part of Grothendieck's work which is used here. It's a part which people usually don't use, but you will see it's useful. And so, well, the same holds for automorphisms for the same formal reasons. If you have a universal family of automorphisms over a scheme, then this scheme is locally of finite type. And it, in particular, its Zariski tangent space at the identity is finite dimensional because the identity belongs to some open subscheme of finite type. But this tangent space is easy to compute directly. And what you get is a space of derivations of the structure sheaf, which is the space of global vector fields on X. And for smooth variety, you get the sections of the tangent bundle. For the affine variety, you get the derivations of the coordinate ring. And now it's an exercise to show that this space of derivations is infinite dimensional as a k-vector space, unless x is a finite set of points. And so you see that the automorphism group of an affine variety of positive dimension has no natural scheme structure, which is maybe not recorded in the literature. But by the work of Fürther and Kraft, it has a natural structure of int variety in characteristic zero. So again, schemes and varieties behave very differently. Okay, so that was a digression. And let me go back to the main body of the talk. So I will give some details on this linearly reductive groups. And first, I will remind you what this means for affine groups. Affine is the same as linear, but I will use affine because otherwise you have linearly reductive groups and it's a bit complicated. Mm-hmm. Okay. And I think you know very well their structures by the theorem of Nagata, which I state as follows. You start with a fine algebraic group in characteristic zero. It's linearly reductive if and only if its neutral component is reductive. And in positive characteristics, you have two conditions. The neutral component is a torus, and the group of components has order prime to p. And in particular, as Dmitry Timashev mentioned, if you assume G to be connected, what you get is the reductive groups in characteristic zero and the tori in characteristic P. So I will also use some formal considerations on the class of affine linearly reductive groups. So which operations can you do on affine groups which preserve linearly reductivity? You can take quotients, that's obvious. Well, you can delete quotients here. That's another mistake. This should be extensions. Sorry. So it's a non-trivial fact that a normal subgroup of linearly reductive group is linearly reductive, and an extension of two of them is still linearly reductive. So that's what I meant. And it's also stable under field extensions. And all these results have been worked out in the paper by Margot. And they will be useful in the talk. So I will need to generalize this linearly reductive groups to possibly non-affine groups. So I also mention a classical result, which is called the affinization theorem, which tells you how far algebraic groups are from affine algebraic groups. And the precise statement is as follows. You start with an algebraic group, and then it has the largest affine quotient group by some normal subgroup n. Largest means that the smallest n, such that G mod n is affine. And this n has a very specific structure. It's connected, it's contained in the center of G naught, and its regular functions are just a constants. So this goes back to a paper of Rosenlicht in 1956 and was reworked in more modern terms 10 years later by de Mazur and Gabriel. So such groups N measure the difference between algebraic groups and affine algebraic groups, and they are called anti-affine by this property.
Michel, Is it true that G affine is just the spectrum of the global or global regular functions on G?
Yes.
So it is always finitely generated, and its spectrum is just this affine quotient. Okay.
You're completely right. That's actually part of the statement, but I didn't put it to be well. Because it's not used, but you're completely right.
Okay.
You take spec of O of G and you get GF. Okay, and you get a natural map also. But I will only need this N basically. And an observation is this N is automatically linearly reductive because it has no non-trivial representations. The matrix coefficients are all constant. And actually, you see with this theorem that G is linearly reductive if and only if so is GF, because every representation of G factors through this quotient. That's quite easy, obvious. And then you get this stability of linearly reductive groups by extensions, just by using this and the work of Margot. Quotients is obvious. Normal subgroups is incorrect in characteristic zero and correct in characteristic positive. This is a strange result, strange remark. We will not use it. And linearly reductive is preserved under field extensions. That's also what I will use. Okay. So now I can start the proof of the existence result. I know I still need the structure of linearly reductive groups. You will see it's a very simple structure up to finite groups. And I will give two statements, one in characteristic zero and one in characteristic positive characteristic. In characteristic zero, G is linearly reductive if and only if it lies in an exact sequence like this, where F1 and F2 are finite, G1 is anti-affine, and G2 is reductive. So again, up to finite groups, linearly reductive groups are just products of reductive times anti-affine. That's what they say. So in positive characteristics, things are very different, and they rely on the notion of semi-abelian varieties, which are extensions of abelian variety by tori. So that's a classical notion in the theory of abelian varieties and related objects. And this gives you further examples of connected commutative linearly reductive groups because their affinization is a quotient of the torus T. And then in positive characteristics, the linearly reductive groups are just extensions of finite groups of order prime to P by semi-abelian varieties. So again, up to finite groups, they are just semi-abelian. And that's what we will use. So the proof of these propositions is not difficult. Well, somewhere, but you have to be just to be careful. And now I can sketch a proof of the existence part of the main result. And it's a kind of reduction to simpler situations, which you have to treat one by one. There are several cases, but all these cases are not difficult. And you start with a very stupid observation. If your group G, which is a source group, is a quotient of group G tilde by some normal subgroup N, then the homomorphisms from G to H are just the homomorphism from G tilde to H, which are trivial on N. Okay, that's basic. But this observation extends to families in a slightly non-trivial way, and it gives the following lemma. If you have a universal scheme for homomorphism from G tilde to H, then you get one for homomorphism to G to H, and it's a closed subscheme of this first one. Okay, so then with this lemma, you can replace G with any kind of overgroup. And in the previous slide, you saw that G is the quotient of a better behaved overgroup. Here, G is a quotient of a product like this. And here, well, you need some other arguments. So let me come back to this. The other argument is another observation. If you have a semi-direct product of two groups, G1 and G2, and you have universal schemes of homomorphisms from Gi to H for I equals 1 and 2. And then you get one for G, and it's closed in the product of them. And, this is based again on a very simple observation that homomorphisms from G to H are just pairs of homomorphism from G1 and G2 to H, which are compatible in some way. And that's it. So now with this observations, we can, we still need some additional ingredient, which is interesting in its own right, and which is due to many people, Borel Serre, Winberg, also myself, in a much greater generality. And it says the following. If you have an algebraic group G and a closed normal subgroup with a finite quotient, and then you can almost lift this finite quotient to G. Actually, you can lift it, but not isomorphically. The statement is there exists a finite subgroup of G such that G is a product N times F. And N times F is what you think is the image of the homomorphism from this semi-direct product to G given by multiplication. And so in this situation, you obtain G as a quotient of a semi-direct product. And by the above lemma, if you have universal schemes from N, H, and F, H, then you get one for G, H. And for F, H is a simple fact that we already used. It's you get one which is closed in H, N, where N is the dimension, the order of F. So in this situation again, we can replace G with N. And for example, we can replace G with G naught. Because this. And so again, using this two structural results, we reduce to G being either reductive or anti-affine. Okay. And then for a reductive group G, there is a deep result of De Masure in a series of works on group schemes, which says basically that if MTH exists, where T is a maximal torus of G, then MGH exists. And hence, you may as well assume that G is T. And then it's a non-trivial exercise to show that this space exists. Basically, you reduce to GLN, and you obtain an explicit description of your N. And I think you can imagine how this works, because the representation theory of Torai is well behaved over a field and actually over any base. And that's what makes this work. And for anti-affine groups, The situation is completely different, and you have to use some rigidity result, which is adapted from the theory of abelian variety, and which says the following. So you start with an anti-affine group and consider group homomorphisms to an algebraic group. And first of all, the image of such groups is contained in the center of H naught. That's very easy because you see the image of G is an anti-affine group. And so it's contained in the largest anti-affine subgroup of H, which is itself contained in this. So that's easy. But now the non-trivial statement is this is isomorphic to some Z to the N. So let me explain what's behind this isomorphism. First of all, G and this one are commutative group now. So you have a structure of group on this set of group homomorphisms just by pointwise multiplication in this target. And this isomorphism is a group isomorphism. And also, this statement is known if G and this other group are abelian varieties. It's also known for tori, and the general case follows by some kind of divisage, some small additional work. So behind this, again, there are reductions to tori and abelian varieties. And then this is a set theoretic description, but actually the scheme theoretic description is exactly the same. And the main ingredient for this is to show that if you have a family of homomorphisms over some connected scheme, then it just doesn't depend on this S. It's just a unique group homomorphism.
Sorry, Michel.
Yes.
You give a proposition for anti-affine groups.
Yes.
Then you say that this is well known for abelian varieties.
Yes.
Yeah, so this novelty is just an extension from abelian varieties to anti-affine groups. So this is novelty of this proposition.
Okay. What should I say? Ingredients are, they use the same ideas, but the precise statements, the details can be very different. Okay. So I will hide all details, so you have to believe me, but that's really what I say. In this statement, I use the theory of abelian varieties in this isomorphism. Because you see, showing that group homomorphism from an abelian variety to another one forms some Zn is a kind of deep result. In the books of abelian varieties, it occurs at chapter maybe 19 in Mumford's book, okay? So you need lots of theory to get there, and I use this. But for the rest, these are direct arguments more or less adapted from part of the theory of abelian varieties. Mm-hmm. And one of these arguments is a rigidity lemma, which proves precisely this. And this lemma is generalized by two Spanish mathematicians called Sancho de Salas. With some, one has to slightly correct what they do, and one gets this. And from this, it follows formally that the universal scheme exists.
Okay.
So that's the end of my talk, but I want to mention a very natural question in this circle of questions. Is there a parameter space or a universal scheme or whatever for subgroups of a given algebraic group. Maybe subgroups of a special type. And there should be one for linearly reductive subgroups. But it's not clear how to obtain it from all these developments. I think one needs additional ingredients. And of course, if you work with Lie algebras, there is a very well-known and well-used parameter space for sub-Lie algebras of a given Lie algebra. It's a variety of Lie subalgebras, which is a very natural object. And for subgroups, it's much more complicated, but there should be some version in this setting. But again, some ingredients are missing for me to get a definite conclusion on this. Okay, so thank you for your attention.
Okay, so thank you for very interesting talk. It's, we learned a lot about it from it already. So are any questions, comments, remarks from participants?
May I ask, do you know if there are generalizations for the cases? I have in mind mainly the case when G is an abelian variety. When you have a H bundle over G, and you consider some sort of homomorphic sections, mm-hmm. whether there is a universal scheme for homomorphic sections of bundles, of H bundles over G.
Well, if you work with abelian varieties, then everything follows from the existence of a Hilbert scheme. Mm. Okay, because sections are special homomorphisms, special morphisms, and spaces of morphisms exist by representability of the Hilbert scheme, right?
You see, there might be cases when there are no homomorphisms at all. For example, if H is a fine without center, yes. But there might be some non-trivial sections of H bundles.
Ah, then this I don't see. I don't see, and I cannot answer the question right now. And I think it's related with the existence of this schemes of subgroups.
Mm-hmm.
Because you just take the graph of your section and you get a subgroup. And,
I see. Mm-hmm.
Okay, so if you have a scheme of subgroups, yeah. Then it's easy to answer our question. But again, I'm unable to get it. So
thank you.
Okay, some other questions?
So I have a question about a result of Winberg, which you quote. You say that it is in some paper of Winberg of 99.
Yes.
Which one?
Which one?
Ah.
I'm just looking at the list of Winberg's papers. I cannot guess which one.
Okay, sorry, there is a too long list. I think it's a paper in a Journal of Lie Theory.
Of 99?
I hope the year is correct, otherwise I have to correct it also. But the paper I remember, I have in mind, is really a paper where he considers the n-tuples of reductive groups.
Ah, yes, at the 96 maybe.
96.
Invariance of a set of matrices.
Yes.
On invariance of a set of matrices. Ah, this one.
This
okay.
One. So it's 96.
Yeah. Maybe.
Okay, it is 96.
So I definitely need to correct all these parts because.
96, yeah, I was right.
At this point, I lost my mind. Okay, so 96. Is there a unique okay. Number of Winberg of this year?
Okay. Yes.
Okay, so I'm lucky, but so this is really on invariance of a set of matrices. And actually, it's a small proposition in this paper. It's not a main result.
Yes.
And I guess that Weinberg worked in zero characteristic, right?
Yes. Yes. And for connected linear algebraic group throughout. But as you see, the extension is very cheap. So
I think he gave a talk on this subject in Oberwolfach in 95. Uh-huh. I remember. Maybe, if okay. I remember correctly.
Mm-hmm. Well, very good.
Okay. But also, Michel, you told that the structure of anti-affine gap groups is well understood.
Yes.
You meant it's because of you, it's your theory. Yes.
I think it's my work, yes. But yes, I yes. think it was somewhere, part of it was behind the lines of our work, especially Rosenlicht.
So it is in your survey on the structure of algebraic groups, basically.
Yes, yes. I think it's useful in several questions, but it's not deep result, okay.
And also, you mentioned preprint of Dean, Oguiza, and you.
Yes.
Is this which you? Is it Rupert, you, or Rupert?
It's a Xun.
It's another you.
There are countably many yous, of course, but it's a Xun you, if I remember correctly.
Okay.
And actually, there's a series of papers by Dean and Oguiza on this kind of topic. And there's the latest one with you in addition, which proves this result. Mm-hmm. In earlier works, they had the same result, but without rational. Okay, so the new information is rational in this paper.
I see. Okay, some other questions? Okay, since there's no more questions, then we thank Michel again for a very inspiring talk and expanding our horizons, extending our horizons. So I don't know how to put this show, the sign of approving, but I'm saying it.
Well, thank you. Thanks for your attention. It was very good for me too.
Okay.